It's wonderful to see all of you here, and we're extremely sorry about the arrangements, but we hadn't anticipated this small shower, and unfortunately there's been, you know, too much crowding, hence in the lobby outside and on the stairs and balconies. So sorry about that. Nonetheless, it's an extremely happy occasion. There's 30 years. Is that a voice from outside? So I did it. So we're celebrating 30 years of subaltern elementary aspects of peasant insurgency. Sorry. And in a sense, also, the year that Elementary Aspects was published was also the year that the Subaltern Studies volume came out, the first one. We're also celebrating 50 years of CSDS. Unfortunately, Partho Chatterjee is not able to be with us today. He was hospitalized and has not been able to come. But nonetheless, we have a wonderful panel for you. Now, many of us are really part of the afterlife of Elementary Aspects. It's what Jim Scott calls the shipyard, the Guha dock, as it were. And as I was reading, rereading Elementary Aspects the past week, one was really struck by a sense of wonderment, the ways in which peasant rebels assemble and confer, the ways in which they hold panchayat meetings, the whole drama of declaring peasant kings, putting on the pagri, the sound of the nagara and the drum, and then the mobilization itself, the attacks on railways, on governmental offices. Ranajit Guha makes much of the bungalow, and even though he is rather skeptical of folklore for the reason that it's elitist and prefers conventional archival sources, I'd like to cite a Mewati doha which suggests the importance of the bungalow, the bangla. Bangla mein man na lage, suni dikhe sej, rai sena ke gorve dekha bina sis angrej. So an English woman contemplates the lonely bungalow and the lonely bed and the Gorwals of Raisena, the village. The Gorwals of the Mewati clan have killed three Englishmen. Now, what I want to do is to really flag certain issues which draws upon my understanding of the Mewatis and the Gujars, who both of whom play such a central role in 1857, and also given the range of insurgencies that we've witnessed in the last few decades, including Manipur, the Kashmir Valley, and central India. And I'll put five broad concerns on the table. The first is that of globalization and insurgency. Ranajit Guha speaks of landlordism as juicery, the conflation of the zamindar and the sahukar, but there's clearly a whole new role of finance capital. And also the fact that the sources of contemporary displacement include upwardly mobile sections of the peasantry, which themselves have become, in many cases, creditors. The second concern is that, and I think this is it's a very widespread concern in India today, is that of the market in land. Elementary Aspects gives us some clues to the way in which land and the way in which it's transformed into a commodity, and the ways in which land is imagined before this transformation. Now, clearly, land grab is something of a global phenomenon, and one is faced with the dominant discourse of industrialization and development, and the fact that a large number of peasants are buying into this discourse. There's an entire huge urban corridor anticipated now connecting Delhi and Bombay, and there's a whole series of industrial areas, malls, multiplexes, gated apartment buildings which are coming up. So from Ranajit Guha's characterization of dominance without hegemony, we're clearly in a situation where both dominance and hegemony are vying with each other for the consent of the governed. And this brings me to the third concern, which is the transformation of territoriality and solidarity. This is one of Ranajit Guha's major concerns in Elementary Aspects. And he clearly sees territoriality as an integral aspect of community formation and of insurgency. Now, instead of the traditional imagination, really, of territoriality, we can see that land use and demographic change are really causing major transformation in territorialities. I mean, if I think of the ideas of Ahirvati, Gujarvati, and Mevat, because of land use and this demographic change, these areas are completely being changed. The fourth issue is that of the communalization of the peasantry. Now, Ranaji spoke of the Santhals and the way in which the Santhal rebellion involved both the Santhals as also the non-tribals and lower classes. But in the last decade, clearly you have the involvement of both Dalits and tribals in genocidal terror against Muslims. The fourth issue I want to flag is that the transformation of the nature of violence. You not only have the extraordinary power of the state, which is manifest, and in our workshop through the day, we had presentations on the Salva Jodum. There's also been Operation Green Hunt. Simultaneously, the story of insurgencies is also an extremely troubled one, and the ways in which open mass activity has become transformed into militaristic action, and the ways in which actually often insurgencies themselves also become vehicles of extortion. Finally, I want to focus on the new ways in which we need to understand the imbrication of the religious and the political. For Ranajit Guha, peasant insurgency involved desacralization. He read it as false consciousness. He was influenced by Kosambi and his reading of bhakti in terms of ancient cults and feudal ideology. And Dipesh has taken him to, task a little, somewhat mildly, by referring to this as anthropologization. But I think we also have, for instance, the possibility of very rich accounts of the religious. Milind Wakankar, for instance, speaks of the coexistence of the miracle and violence, and the miracle being a moment when a poet such as Kabir has an insight into the nature of divinity. So friends, let me call on our first speaker, Shahid Amin.
Thanks, Shell, for helping us organize this two-day gathering. When these celebrations for 150 years of 1857 took place with official patronage, this has nothing to do with. They were, not only on 50 years and then 60 years of hanging of Bhagat Singh and in whatever it is, but in this case it makes sense. 50 years of Subaltern Studies, 30 years of Elementary Aspects, and 90 years this May of Ranajit Guha. And we, as you know, I regard him as an ustad, and it's very clear that I do so and I've said so. And so this is a particularly almost an emotional experience to have so many people, pasina chutra. I mean, literally, I used to, sweat in school, and after that I stopped. But now it has come back again. It's really very gratifying to see so many people. And it's not simply a description that the population of India has increased a lot in the past 30 years, but it's really, really. very, very, very gratifying. And thank you, all of you, for making CSDS, not follow fire regulations and so on. Now, all of us, and you know, what I have to say, of course, is reading elementary aspects, but also about Ranajit Guha. But I will say that the book, well, the author is very much there. And the other complication or other aspect is that a lot of us who who were on the wrong side of 30 when we met him, and now we're on the wrong side of 60, really grew up, intellectually grew up with him. And so that was absorbed a lot. And I first came to know Ranajit Guha in 1970 when I was an undergraduate. And then, from 73, I used to meet him in Gyan very often. And so it's a question, at least in my case, of kis tarah maine atmasat kiya hai, and I won't talk about it. But let me start by referring to something that Shell alluded, this James Scott. I was trying to look for my old copy, and it's there somewhere, but it's nice to read another copy of Subaltern Studies. So, and Scott talks about the shipyard, but he also talks about Subaltern Studies as somewhat an underground text outside Indian historiography. And let me share this, and Dipesh will bear me out. It was also an underground text, not only within Indian historiography, but also within Subaltern Studies in some cases. Those who were in England had greater access. And when we all met, and Sumit was there in 1983 for the first Subaltern Studies conference, we were allowed to read it, but not photocopy it. And Dipesh was caught by none other than the author of the book. Routledge, Keegan Paul, and Cambridge University Press should note, photocopying it in the bookshop in Australian National University. And it was all finalized. In fact, but even before that, the thing is that elementary aspect was finalized. I mean, I was the first person to read the whole thing, and I wrote an 11-page, thing. And the only thing that he changed but one particular phrase, and he pointed out, other things that he didn't want to change. Like I'd said, why not use the word thanedar? He said, no, it is actually thanadar. I know, I've looked at it. So that's the way it came about with me. Myself, it's particularly, in fact, I read it as one reads, a novel as it is serialized in a magazine. Because I read chapters as they were typed, and I was doing economic history, and I used to read it, and so I read some chapters. I read transmission and territory and modality, and I straight away, because I was in England, could go and follow up the references. Vacek and Jacobson and Bartlett on remembering, and an obscure article by J. Prasad on the rumors that circulated after the Great Bihar earthquake in the Journal of the Psychological Society of, Psychological Society of Britain. So, in a way, it was a different kind of a reading, because that allowed me to read the text and also follow the footnotes, which is what historians, normally do. So it also helped me transit from, being an economic historian to working on popular politics and culture. My article in volume one was, small peasant production, commodity production, and a very learned reviewer rightly perhaps said that it has no place in subaltern studies. But it allows me. Now, what is, I'm going to try and suggest the ways I now revisit this text and read it again. So it's a lot of, we have talked about how, Guha is such a master craftsman, it's a writerly achievement. But if you follow, the way he writes, and then one could say that he's not just a stylist, but a historian stylist. And that is what I like to emphasize, so that ways of writing is not to fill gaps. The ways of writing, or a particular way in which sentence is structured, or a particular way in which a paragraph is broken, is in terms of, because he has the material, to then decide how he's writing. So that is what style is for a historian, rather than, you know, plain speak or plain writing or, you know, whatever. And that's important. And secondly, that he writes as an Indian, not in the, you know, Indic sense of the word, that I have greater access to, you know, to things Indian, but as a cosmopolitan historian, he writes as an Indian. And you find markers of this in sentences which, you know, and this is a work which kind of goes all over, you know, the world, geographically and through various disciplines, and every now and then there is this phrase, our, or our past, or our country, and this is very, very deliberate, in which she's not saying, you know, dur hato hai dunya walo, Hindustan hamara hai, but that there is an investment which requires one not to stick to things Indian, but to go out and explore and then, you know, write about India in almost a possessive way. Let me just read this section. We're discussing this in the morning. Manu is so central, and he quotes in this paragraph on page 46, you know, the corporal punishments prescribed for those, you know, who break the knowledge code. Have his tongue cut out, an iron nail 10 fingers long thrust red hot into his mouth, etc. This is the end of the paragraph. And then the next paragraph begins, this ancient recipe, quote, bracket, by no means uniquely Indian, for dealing with verbal delinquency by destroying the organs of the speech, offers some idea of the linguistic control in an authoritarian society. And what was sought to be controlled was not the spoken word alone, but also the zero sign of utterance, that is silence, used formally and yet eloquently enough as a significant absence of speech. And then he will, in the paragraph, will go and talk about how in Untouchable in Kerala, when speaking to a Nambudri Brahmin, would put his hand over, when listening to him, would put his hand over his mouth. But there's a footnote on page 46 itself when he talks about punishment and says, for an English and relatively recent parallel, this is quoting Manu, for an English and relatively recent parallel, see the case of 17th century author of a blasphemous publication who was punished by having a hole bored through his tongue, Hill, 1972, The World Turned Upside Down. Or, you know, so that's another very, very important way, so that, you know, the normal scholarly convention, when, you know, which is, you know, when you say we, you are implicating the author in the argument. We may well, we hereby, so we see that. And when you say I, it is the author who speaks. There are many books that I have read as an undergraduate on ancient Indian material which say that when I say I, you know, it is personal, and we, the reader, is complicit. Ranjit doesn't say I, he doesn't say we, he says our. And otherwise, there are very, very, very interesting ways in which new paragraphs begin and how long passages are cut into new paragraphs. And you should just talk about it a lot. Or take this passage towards the end of the book, epilogue, where he's making the connection. And the book is about 1757 to 1900, and yet he says, well, everywhere, all subsequent events, movements will have some elements of this. He does not say that this structure would be replicated. Our country, many of the mass movements that have swept through our land since then bear at least some of its hallmarks, right? Here's our land. Or, you know, take this very interesting passage on drums and other, you know, surrogate sound emissions which are not linguistics. And, you know, and there's this obscure references to Seebok and Seebok, drum and whistle sounds, which I did check up in that library. I wanted to use it in my work, but, you know, I didn't even put it in the reference. Now, this is about drum and the flute and the horn, and I'll say something about the drum. He says, the drum, the flute, and the horn were the instruments most used for oral transmission of insurgency. They formed a clue class apart from verbal media in the sense that they helped to realize what Jacobson has called transmutation, that is, an interpretation of verbal sign by means of signs of non-verbal sign systems. In terms of the volume and variety of messages, the operation of such substitutive system was perhaps not nearly so elaborate in our country as it was in Africa. It's not as widespread in India as it was in Africa. So it uses our and I in and our past in very, 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 very thoughtful ways. Now, the other thing I wanted to share is that, you know, Ranajit Guha, I think Partho mentions it in his introduction to The Small Voice of History. He wrote this work without any sabbatical, without any grant. And I guess he was able to write it with that kind of archival depth because not because he started doing that work, all this board collection and so on. He'd worked on this 25 years, 30 years ago. And he was now then bringing it to bear. And earlier on, when he talked about, he said that I'm working on this book, which perhaps would be called The Seven Cuts, because that was one of the modes by which the Coles punished their enemies. But it then developed into, had the title that it does. Now, there is, the title is the Peasant Then and Now, and Partho, if he was here, would have tried to, you know, and he's written about it, alluded to it, that, you know, whether we need to think in fresh ways about what is happening to peasant politics and peasant movements today, especially, you know, in Bengal and so on. I am not going to, make that kind of a generalization. So is he, you know, appropriate? In some ways, you know, this is a text most centrally about colonial India. And as historians, we have a certain investment in that, irrespective of whether you know it applies today or not. But that's problematic, you could say, because after all, Guha writes 1757 to 1900, before the coming of mass nationalism, and then says all the movements that have happened subsequently have some traces. So when I was reading, I wrote a long letter to him about trying to think through what would be happening with mass nationalism. Not just throwing, if you look at Rollat Satyagraha and this, it would have some elements, but when we were speaking. So, you know, some things that came to mind and which I tried to use is, first of all, you know, collective corporate labor and hunting as a metaphor for mobilization. That would be very, very limited in Pakka peasant societies during nationalist mobilization. The role of writing, for instance, not of the sort that he talks about, going back to Claude Lévi-Strauss and so on, or the use of clothes in a particular fashion. You know, there's this very interesting discussion on the body, which is quoting Hegel, that it assumes its full semioticity through dress, and he talks about the red dress that some of the Santals wore in imitation of authority, but also of their authority, and that. For those who have read my work, it's the, which gives me the idea about looking at Gerua color very carefully. And also whether the ideology of the peasant is centrally defined in terms of a negative or diminutive aspect of the ideology of the dominant. Because some of us who have worked on this, we have tried to mine and undermine folklore in a different way. And that comes, in the very beginning, there are two paras on folklore. One, that it's not substantial enough, purely quantitatively, that, what you get on Santal from this, all the folklore will not, be one third of it. And the second is that it is elitist. So that folklore, almost Ranajit Guha is saying, cannot be a part of the instruments of the historian's trade. You can rely on Crook, and he does. And when talking about chapatis, you can look at colonial ethnography, but you as it were, you can't generate your own folklore. There's nothing really on field work, which is understandable because this is 1757 to 1900. But there is a way in which, as Gyan Prakash's first book shows, not only are there colonial descriptions from Grayson and so on about the relationship between the Kamiya and the Bhuya, the bonded laborers, but there is also material that is generated in conversations that Gyan Prakash has with Bhuyas, and a lot of very interesting insights come because they can be related to what is there archivally. There is this absolutely brilliant story recounted about the thraldom in which these bonded laborers are held through the instrumentality of what is called Malik Devtas, Devtas that are owned by the Malik, and they are at the service of the Malik, and how completely, what a complete domination they exercise, which is the same thing, almost it is the same thing that Ranjit Guha is talking about. But this story comes through, a conversation with somebody, perhaps this woman, who says that, look, I was possessed, and then it was the Ojha discovered that actually it is the Malik Devta of my father's village that has got hold of me and is punishing me because of some grain that I had pilfered from my father's kitchen before getting married. This is not in Grayson, unless Prakash is putting this across as his own. No, but that's what I suggest, that Guha, it's not that the impossibility of doing field work or one's own ethnography in that period, but in terms of his argument, this inversion argument and reading the text is so central to open the space. That almost by definition, he has to not pay enough attention theoretically also to others other aspects. Now the other thing of course is we in history and social sciences we keep on taking turns. The linguistic turn, and now is the time for the visual turn. And there is very little in Guha's writing. There's so much of prose of counterinsurgency, but both 1857 and the Santhals rebellion are the running thread throughout elementary aspect, and this is what he used to say. If you go, there's so many other things, but the 1857 rebellion and the Santhal are central, and there's of course a lot of visual material on 1857. Woodcuts, Beato's photographs, and even a Danish painter that came. And of course, there is this masterly discussion of the Santhal society, the prehistory of the rebellion, when he looks at secondary discourse in prose of counterinsurgency. That is the article called The Aborigines of Birbhum by W.W. Hunter. Now, this image comes from the same series, from the Illustrated London News that we have chosen the poster image for. And now this is a Santhal village. A very idyllic and nothing really is, this is peasant time, the grain is taking its time. Nothing much is happening. Now this is a really peculiar presentation of the Santhals attacking. And this is almost, one feels that it could well be the part of a book by Paddon on Latin America or something like that. This kind of a savage, idea. So we decided that this is not, not only politically incorrect, but it doesn't make sense. So we chose the image that we have chosen. Yeah, and this is it. And the poster is from here. Now just look at this. This says the whatever native infantry returning after burning a village and recovering loot. And just look at this. There are these natives carrying this, and obviously this almost is the wholesale, the complete taking away of the way grain is stored you know, these three carts, and then their whole set of heads of cattle. And then these are these Kalu soldiers, because this is native infantry, but looking almost, you know, Angrez-like, you know, this is like the leader of the, you know, the slave rebellion in you know, what's it called? This French, the first rebellion. Kya naam hai? French naam hai uska. Yeah, yeah. You know, almost, you know, there's this image of his. And then there are other soldiers, and this is the smoke coming out of the, you know, villages that are burning. So this is the prose, the picture of counterinsurgency, which you know, which we chose. And there's perspective, there's distance, and this is from the Illustrated London News, 57 or so. And Guha, I'm just going to end. And Guha relies a lot on almost a contemporary article in Calcutta Review called the Santhal Rebellion. I'll just you know, just I'm going to read that. Yeah. And so there is this, you know, yes, and this is important because this also, you know, plays out the idea that the insurgency, the modalities of insurgencies are also made available through the actual, you know, picking up or reversing what the insurgency has, you know, has achieved by recovering it, you know, so, you know, I'll just read passages from it, and I'm going to end very soon. For it was not money that was plundered the most. Grain was our chief plunder and cattle, said Kanu. And then he goes on to talk about how each and every expedition by a certain Captain Phillips or certain this was to hunt for, burn, and then recover plunder. And, you know, in some ways, this is what this picture is about. And now to end, you know, Geertz has this famous statement, what do anthropologists do? They write. I think historians would be nowhere unless they wrote, and unless they wrote well. You know, Ranjit, this goes back to 1970, I won't take any names. He used to live, I was an undergraduate, used to live in Riviera apartments, said, well, that historian, you know, the evidence crawls all over the page. Perhaps there should have been two volumes, you know, of this, just one for the evidence and the other, you know, for referring to where the evidence comes from. I won't name the author. It's a major foundational text of modern Indian history. So that, you know, the andaz-e-bayan is very distinctive about Ranjit Guha. And every historian has got some andaz-e-bayan, you know. But, you know, yun to hai dunya mein muarrikh bahut acche, kehte hain ki andaz-e-bayan aur. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dipesh Chakravarti. And who knows, you know. So 30 years of elementary aspects, 30 years of our lives, 30 years of Ranjita's life. And in today's discussions that we've had through the day, this question was coming up, at least in my head, but in other people's heads too, perhaps, as to, you know, what's living and what's dead about subaltern studies, and what remains with us from elementary aspects, and what may have fallen through the trapdoor of history, and thinking about it. About any great work, actually, it has always seemed to me that we remember great works and important works, and we keep going back to them, not always because their answers persuade us. I mean, there are times when answers do persuade us. If an answer seems persuasive over a long time, it becomes part of our common sense. It takes a long time for someone else to question it. But because the fundamental questions that the work is asking. Those questions are generative. So often in the classroom, I say, look, in the social sciences, nobody's right in the end. The aim should be to make a very interesting mistake. Now, we don't set out to make a mistake, but if you end up having made an interesting mistake, then it's that mistake which in its layered structure keeps inviting people, drawing people to it. And I think Elementary Aspects and Ranjita's work and what he taught us in Subaltern Studies raised some very, very interesting questions which have remained with us as questions. He gave some answers. He answered those questions. The answers sometimes are debatable and have been debated for right reasons. And because I'm a historian in the time given to me, I'll pick on three themes which I think are important to historians and where I think Elementary Aspects still actually has a lot to contribute. So one is the question of historical time. How do we think about time in India? Even today, just, you know, when just the last issue of the Open magazine, which has a very critical essay on Ashishta and the controversy to do with Ashish Nandi, the author says something which I've read all the time in growing up in India, that we're not, Indians don't all live in the same time. You know, you have this experience of our living in several centuries at once, or some people living in another time, and you know, so this question, are we all liberal, are we all progressive? And this author was concluding his essay by saying, why don't we admit that this is a very fragmented country, and there are different time zones, as it were, in this country, in which, or let's say, time-space structures in which people live. So this question in India, it comes up in many other contexts, is what do we do with something that seems, that's still alive, has a tremendous impact on my life, but which seems to belong to another time, and the time of the past, not a time of the future. I mean, some people seem ahead of their time, some people seem to be living in, you know, some say, I mean, like, you know, so-and-so is very feudal, attitudes are feudal. I mean, you use these terms loosely, but we use them. And when I, my first meeting with Ranjit Guha was in England, and when he was in Sussex, I'd gone to do my PhD work, and he was going to move to ANU, we knew that, so I called him up, and, you know, he had already decided that he was interested in me and in inducting me, I guess, into Subaltern Studies. So I had to go through the rituals of that induction. So the first ritual, he said, yes, you know, come and spend a whole weekend with me. And I thought, good Lord, you know, what will I say to this man over a whole weekend? So I went, and the advantage was that, you know, there are, again, many structures of conversation. So if you think of a very modern structure of conversation, which is what happens in this kind of structure in a seminar, you know, something that's a very marketplace phenomenon, which is queuing up to get something, has come into the formal structure of a seminar conversation. So you, when you raise your hands, you're queuing up, and you wait for your turn. And if somebody talks for too long, you stop listening because you kind of think, you know, they're taking my time away. Or, you know, they're taking more than their share of time, right? And that has happened. I think post-war, if you read older, you know, histories of older seminars like Heidegger's seminars or Hegel's, perhaps, the master spoke for as long as the master wanted, and it was democratic. So if you actually stretched your sense of time, you would have a conversation, except that you would enter the conversation on the third day. You know, so you'd have a dialogue, but you had to sort of had a different conception of time. So when I went there, I realized why Ranjita said, come for the weekend. So having gone there, I listened. Before the day closed, he said to me, there are two reasons why I couldn't sleep at all the first night. One was, of course, a simple fact that he said to me, have you read Foucault? And I said, no, I haven't. I've heard the name. This was 79. And he said, okay, here's Discipline and Punish, read it tonight. Now that, you know, and what kind of a torture is that, you know, for a guest? I mean, you give somebody Discipline and Punish, I mean, it's like, sat up all night, finish the book. But before that, I'd already lost sleep, because what Ranjit did, he sat me down and read out to me from his manuscript the chapter which became Negation. And you know, I'd done physics, I had not history. I'd come into history with, you know, Barunde and Sumidda and all these Marxist historians who were my mentors. And I had grown up with two assumptions. One is that in history, if you connect point A with point B, you need document and data to connect them. And B, that in Indian history, if you knew Sanskrit, you did ancient Indian history. If you need Persian, you did Mughals. And if you knew English and in addition a vernacular language, then you did the modern period. That was very clear to me. And suddenly this man, as he's reading the chapter, he jumps from Manu to a 19th century incident of torture. And I have two reactions sitting there. I think first of all, how the hell does he do that? How do you go from Manu straight to 19th century without any kind of discussion of the intervening periods? Besides, I was thinking, I was even more struck, because it didn't seem meaningless. And what he said made sense. And I was sitting there thinking, you know, I didn't need either Manu or that 19th century document to know the truth of what he was saying. Because I'd grown up in India, in which I'd seen those sorts of human violations to happen again and again. And there was... And then I realized, I was in England for 3 months, and I would speak to him on the phone, and I realized that the trick for him, the magic way of doing it, was actually that he was using structuralism. So he was using structuralism to say that even an ancient cultural code can survive into another context as a cultural code. So a human experience can get abbreviated, encapsulated in something that you repeat and you don't even know it belongs to an earlier period, and it happens in front of your eyes. So that those 3 months, I actually bought as many structuralist books as I could, gave myself a tutorial. I'd come back from archives and read, you know, Jacobson and Levi-Strauss and Roland Barthes and all these people. And from then, I came to Delhi. You know, this was very heady. I was on my way to Calcutta. Ranjitha would come to Calcutta and induct Partho and Gautam. And I was going to be the message bearer, you know, telling them about the new. And I had the enthusiasm of a neophyte. So in the meanwhile, he had read out to me this manifesto of Subaltern Studies. I had signed, and the document was signed and sealed that I was going to join the group. And and I came to Delhi with this newfound structuralism in my head. And I was going to see, I was going to go from Daryaganj, take an auto rickshaw, to the Delhi University side to see two very dear and old friends who were in Delhi. And on the way to the Delhi University side, I was going through Chandni Chowk, and suddenly in front of the scooter, a man appeared carrying a bird of prey, a falcon, on the back of his hand. And my scooter driver, the scooter screeched to a halt, and the man said, "Shabash." And I, having imbibed all this structuralism, you know what happened to me immediately? Everything that was not Shahjahanabad melted away. So that I suddenly forgot about the electric light posts. I forgot about the buildings that looked really shoddy, Delhi, 20th century. You know, suddenly I thought I could have been in Chandni Chowk, in Shah Jahan's Delhi, and I could have been walking by, and there could have been this man carrying this royal bird on his hand, and I could have been a Jat peasant, which is what probably my screwdriver was. And what would I have said? I'd have said Shabash, because there was the cultural code of heroism. And I suddenly saw structure. And I remember writing to Gautam Bhadra, I said, you know, structure exists, I've just encountered it. Later on, but I went to the, but you know, all this stuff was so new in Indian history, because Indian history was broadly Marxist. And I went to these two dear friends of mine, and they, with a lot of affection, and with a perhaps even more concern, said to me, Foucault has gone to your head. And the stuff was so new that I thought, it's not Foucault, it's Levi-Strauss who's gone to my head. If somebody's gone to my head, it's Levi-Strauss, it's not Foucault. But the stuff was very new. And I realized that Ranjit Dutt was his answer to the question of our everyday experience of heterogeneity of time in India, the plurality of times that we experience. That's the question, plurality of times, we experience it. His answer was through structuralism. Now, structuralism brings its own problems. The answer may or may not have been right. I think there are problems with structuralist answers, but the question remains. That's why the question comes up in discussions of liberalism, Ashish Nandi, gang rape, women's freedom, modernity. I mean, that question doesn't go away. And I think it really was Ranjit Dutt's historiography that suddenly made that question real for me. So that's about time. Let me quickly go to the subject question, the historical subject. Now, of course, Gayatri is here. And Gayatri made a terrific and very important intervention in our work by asking the epochal question she asked, can the subaltern speak? But before that, before I encountered Gayatri, one day I walked into Ranjit Dutt's office in Canberra. And, these bookshelves going up, this is my memory of it. And we were talking, and suddenly Ranjit Dutt points to a book high up on his shelves where you normally can't reach without standing on a stool. And Ranjit Dutt was not a tall person. And he said, and the book said on its spine, Grammatology. And he said, see, by then we had all read Foucault, and we were either using Foucault to revise Marx or using Marx to revise Foucault. So we were kind of, the mission was correct Foucault, correct Marx, get to the right kind of Marxism. And Ranjit Dutt looks at this book and says, have you read this book, Grammatology? No, I said. He said, amiyo porini, nor have I. But it's a very important book. So naturally, what do? I go to the bookshop. Ranjit Dutt says, I buy it. And of course, so you have to wait for Gayatri to come and explain. But before Gayatri comes into our group, let me say, this whole question of, it was not surprising that as Bengalis we hadn't read it because, as I used to quip, that, deri da, we get. Right. So, Derida, then mediated by Deri Didi, but that's different. but Ranjit Dutt actually made a very interesting point about the question of the subject, which I think is fascinating and has remained. It takes me to my third point, but I'll say what this first point was. This point was that. Subaltern studies, elementary aspects, is a story of mobilizations. There's a kind of a, almost, sometimes you call it insurgent consciousness, but actually gets to this consciousness through modes of mobilization. Use of rumors, use of laboring implements, use of kinship. It's really about modes of mobilization. That's why Gyan's first book, written under Ranjit Dutt's intellectual influence, was about mobilization. Now, logically, there's always a problem going to anybody's consciousness from their behavior. Because the same behavior can be produced by many different states of consciousness. So, but putting that question to one side, what I thought was, and I've increasingly thought is fascinating about Ranjit Dutt's attempt to do what he was trying to do. If you look at European historiography of riots, what do people do? Rude and others? You immediately go to the court. You go to the court documents, which are about assigning culpability and responsibility. So you individuate the crowd. In other words, you break the crowd up into individual faces. And Ranciere and others have pointed out very interestingly that this is a very statist practice. It's a kind of Hobbesian idea of the collective here, where the state is made up of contracts between individuals. So every crowd is eventually break up into these mentionable individuals, identifiable individuals, and therefore you can punish them. Whereas we all know that when a riot happens, the agency is collective and it's evanescent. Which is why actually either in Rude's book or in Shahid's book on Chauri Chaura, you'll find statements like, you know, somebody's asked, so why did you join the riot? They would say, because everybody was doing it. You know, or everybody in the village said, let's go there. So these are all figurations of ways of talking about that collective agency that Ranjit Dar refuses in elementary aspects to individuate crowds. And actually makes room in Indian history, this is a historicizable proposition, he doesn't historicize it. He makes room in Indian history for a certain figure we have seen recur again and again. And what's that figure? I mean, initially, so that's his subject, not individualized, not consciousness is not what goes on inside the individual's heads. It's not anthropological in that sense. It's not Clifford Geertzian, you know, how do they make sense of their worlds. It's not culturalist. He calls it insurgent consciousness. But really, he's trying to find the name of a subject that is a collective subject, but evanescent. That doesn't quite document itself directly. It can't say, I did it. There is no I that can speak in that sort of fashion. And that's not just India. I mean, you know, Ginsberg's Ben Andante book. I mean, many books will actually speak of that kind of subject. But Subaltern Studies marked, I think, Ranjita's book, not Subaltern, Ranjita's book, and then it shows up in Shahid's book too, makes the first departure from the tradition of individuating crowds, which is exactly what the police do. So actually it's a refusal to use the police methods as the historian's archival method. And I'll suggest it to you that that's a major, major difference between Guha's book and Carlo Ginzburg's essay called The Inquisitor as Anthropologist. You know, because the Inquisitors basically are forerunners of modern police practices of individuating crowds. What then, I think, the third point I want to make about the lasting legacy of elementary aspects is that it really, you know, today this thing came up. In Subaltern Studies, we were not thinking about democracy. We were thinking about modernity, nation, socialism. But one of the interesting features of Indian democracy and many other emerging democracies is the use of deliberate use of disorder as a way of bargaining. You know, one major difference between a political party in liberal Western democracy and a political party here is that if you cannot be an effective political party in India, if you are not capable, talking about capacities, if you don't have the capacity to produce mayhem on the streets as part of your bargaining process. That's the major difference. In other words, there is a social production of disorder which political parties organize and make use of. And I would say that the kind of subject that Ranjit Dar wrote about, that collective, evanescent, even violent subject, is part of the genealogy of the subject of the disorder of modern democracy. And we can, you know, if you have time, we can discuss this later, but that's my third proposition, that actually Ranjit Dar's elementary aspects and subaltern studies can be read as providing a genealogy. The reason why I said it's historicizable, it's quite clear, it's not completely rural, that subject. So even though we call it peasant insurgency, and you know why? It's one of the, I mean, Shahid talked about the Santal Rebellion and the 1857 mutiny being running themes. One of the running, one of the continual and I'll say almost fixed aspects of this subject of disorder is the institution of the bazaar. And the bazaar, bazaar is a historicizable phenomenon. You can imagine in India when there were no bazaars. But if you write the history of bazaars, you would be writing history of trade. You'd be writing history of urban formations. It's a long history. It's not just, you know, modern bazaars. But it's clear that it's those institutions, melas, bazaars, where people traveled and got together. It's in those sorts of sites that this subject was born. It's from bazaars that rumors went around, originated. And that kind of proximity as well as anonymity, all those things that happen in those spaces. We have not done that work. I'm not saying it's been historicized, but now when I look back to get back to elementary aspects and I read it, I often go back to it. It's a great text and there's a lot to learn from it. And the more I go back, the more I feel convinced that even though we consciously didn't make democracy into an object to be addressed in subaltern studies, Subaltern studies and elementary aspects can be read as providing a genealogy, not the genealogy, but a genealogy of the subject that's active in the disorder of Indian democracy today. Okay, I'll finish there. Thank you very much.
Given that his name is up there, I actually need to introduce myself. I'm not Partho Chatterjee. And to become Partho Chatterjee, I'm getting there in one way. I'm losing hair very rapidly. But I'd also have to grow that chewable beard, which may take a bit longer. And the other thing is I'd have to become Bengali in a quintessential way. And one of the things about the early subaltern studies, or subaltern studies from beginning to end in some ways, was it was thought of as this great adda of Bengalis, right? I was in a seminar conference in Santa Cruz, where I happened to sit behind somebody who was making notes on subaltern studies, and the contributors put the names down, and by each one, Shahid Amin, Bengali Brahman. You know, every single name was Bengali Brahman to this particular person. And Shumit says that's right.
But,
exactly. So, in any case, Shahid and I were interlopers in this Bengali Brahman community very early on, and happily for us, many other interlopers have joined the crowd subsequently. Gyan Prakash, you know, more Biharis, as it were. Gyan Prakash, Naji Askaria, and Susi Tharu, and Shail Mayaram, you know, all sorts of people. So, in a sense, it's kind of opened up. But in any case, I'm not Partho Chatterjee. And the reason I say that is that I was asked this afternoon to speak in his place. And of course, being somewhat sensible, I said, don't be ridiculous, and I haven't thought about this. And they said, you've been thinking about it for 30 years. Yeah, you can do it, 10-minute talk. Now, one of the things some of us said in one subaltern studies conference was that Kapil Dev in his last years was bowling from memory. And unfortunately, that's what I may have to end up doing. I haven't, and I should have, but I haven't spent the last week looking at elementary aspects again. So sadly, against my will, I shall be bowling from memory a little bit. I want to thank Shail and Shahid and CSDS for organizing this and inviting us all here. I want to thank you. I mean, it's extraordinary to have people turn out in these numbers, and I have many old friends here, but I see many, many young people, people whom I hope will be part of an intellectual community that I will share something with, and some of whom I will get to know, some of you. I say this because one of the great things about Ranajit Guha, and I heard it again in recent times from Gayatri one time when I visited New York, was this thing that I want to talk to young people. Ranajit would constantly say that, you know, they're boring. I don't want to talk to those people. Which is us. We need to talk to younger people, because there's a great deal that working with and talking to another generation with fresh insights, different kinds of experiences, brought to Ranajit Guha, to Gayatri Spivak, to all of us, quite obviously. And it was one of the most heartening things that we had in those weekend kinds of gatherings with Ranajit, that he listened. That's wrong. He spoke very seriously. But in some senses, what was interesting was that he wanted these meetings all the time. And he said this repeatedly, that you don't know how much I get out of it. You do not know how much these conversations mean to me. He also said about, because some of us had about finished our PhDs when we got to know him. And he would say things like, you know, to more than one of us, I'm sure he said this, we've been thinking about this a long time. You've proved it. And that's, in some senses, the kind of man he was when he came to Delhi in 70-71. He was thought of as and pronounced the Naxalite professor on campus. You know, politics and immediate political concerns meant a great deal to him. It was clear. This is something that informed his work, that he saw in our work, and that has made all the difference, it seems to me, to the work that was produced from Elementary Aspects on to Subaltern Studies the whole way through. And the fact that there is a political, what should I say, criticism that is addressed not only outwards but inwards. It is addressed to the work we have done. It's continuous in that sense. So 30 years, the peasant then and now, is that kind of question. You know, what's missing? What would we do? What needs to be done very differently? That's the question that's been asked. And it's an enormously important question. I do want to say that both Shahid and Dipesh have given us a fundamental, very, very critical part of the answer, which is, if you've asked the right questions, then in a sense you might last much longer than, you know, if you provided what would have been seen as the right answers. And I think the questions were what counted. So I'm going to do this, I hope, more briefly than Shahid and Dipesh, but I'm going to touch on some things that have perhaps not been emphasized as much by them as they might be, but things that have come up in the discussion this morning and things that they have certainly already pointed towards. One thing that struck me in reading Elementary Aspects all those years ago, when all that he would change, as Shahid said, after getting comments from us, would be a comma, you know? Okay, I'll make that a semicolon if you're really that fast. One thing that struck me then was how much attention there was to detail that on the face of it had no real significance. The utensils that somebody carried, the things that were found in the pockets of a peasant rebel. And I remember some of us saying, at least to ourselves, I'm not sure if we had the guts to say it to Ranjit at that point, but, you know, what's the significance of this trifling detail? You know, what does it add up to? And I think that was the significance, that we asked the question as much as anybody else would have asked, why this trifling stuff? And in a sense, I think what Ranjit Guha was already doing in a way that he actually talked about as instinct. There was something very interesting, and so let me say the instinct part first. I'm going to talk about the instinct and about the trifling just for a moment. And he said, what we need is not only scientific evidence, the archive, you know, that whole barrage of stuff. We need that. But there's a great deal that the historian learns from and can gain from. Instinct. Right? And so in some senses, instinctively, I think, not by reading the great theorists and learning it, you don't have to read grammatology even if it's sitting up there. Instinct already takes you some part. It's great to read it, and it's important to have Gayatri Spivak come and interpret it for you as well. But it's very important to think that instinct takes one to some of the same kinds of questions. And so Dipesh's point about not needing either Manu or the 19th century document, because in some senses, you instinctively could see the force of what was being said, the force of the question that was being asked. So a traditional historical discipline would hesitate, would be troubled. Feminism was not troubled by this kind of thing. But instinct was something that Ranajit Guha was willing to foreground and insist upon as part of our inheritance, as part of the thing we need to work with. The other, as I said, was the trifling stuff that would have been dismissed as trifling. And many of us have continued to work with this recent work I'm doing with colleagues in the United States and in India, deals with the realm of, or the rubric, let's say, of unarchived histories. Unarchived histories, which I have the subtitle for, the mad and the trifling. The realm of unreason as being unarchived to a very large extent, but not only in the form of its paradigmatic form of the mad, which actually is archived in some ways, but of the trifling, of that is dismissed as trivial, as of no consequence, which is, in fact, perhaps, the largest area of human history, past and present, political and everything else. And it is the contestation between that is dismissed as trifling and that makes it either into the realm of madness or into the realm of reason that is history, right? And so this was then an attention not only to the trifling and its dismissal, but an attention to the question of what constituted history. What were the boundaries of this? And how did those boundaries come to be made in the first place? So, Ranjita said to us many times over, and I imagine we've all said this to our students, and all of you are very well aware of this. I don't need to repeat it. In some senses, I don't need to repeat it. I'm going to repeat it. So, the point was, it became impossible for a historian like Ranajit to do history without historiography. It was absolutely central, and he said it repeatedly, we cannot do history without doing historiography at the same time. In other words, before we had read Foucault, before he perhaps had read Foucault in quite the way in which, you know, many of you will have by now, he was asking, how do we know what we know? Well, you know, how do we come to privilege the kinds of documents, the kinds of evidence, or certain kinds of documents, certain kinds of evidence, how do we come to pronounce something as historical or non-historical, as political or non-political? All these questions run right through elementary aspects of peasant insurgency. And so, Shell, I would say that in some senses, that move to say folk tales is not the only place to go was not a privileging of the official archive. It was actually simply saying it's a privileging of new questions. You ask the new questions, you will produce a new archive, as it were, sometimes out of the very same documents. In a sense, the archive is produced by the questions that we ask. That was the fundamental proposition. And so, you know, I think there just moves, many of them made instinctively, I have no doubt, but moves that were of enormous significance and that have come, to some extent, to be part of a common sense that we have all inherited and that we work with. So in an interesting way, elementary aspects laid this out, and Ranajita worked with this all the way through his writings, perhaps even in History at the Limits of World History, though I'm told now he's painting more, or not writing history. But in any case, he lived with these concerns for a very long time. What happened was a juxtaposition of things that weren't a foregrounding of questions and domains that were not always foregrounded in this way and together. He was interested in the state and in critique of the state. He read the state as history very often, a state that could not actualize itself in any other way, actualized itself by a certain kind of writing of history, right? That couldn't find its power in other ways. But he read the state history alongside the everyday all the way through, right from the beginning. And he read it alongside the question of knowledge. So knowledge power, but in a fundamental way before Foucault, you know, makes this kind of mantra available to everybody, or our reading of Foucault makes the mantra available. To which this morning's session has added, and very importantly added, the question of wonder, which I think was also part of what Ranjita was dealing with in thinking about peasant insurgency and so on and so forth. He constituted in elementary aspects of peasant insurgency, we've said this repeatedly, several people have said this today, and I think we're well aware of it, an insurgent consciousness which was talking about the will and history and volition of the peasant, right? Not as an empirical category, but as axiomatically something that required investigation. And I just want to emphasize that proposition about the state, knowledge, the everyday. That combination, that complex, makes for an investigation which is fairly unusual, right? And allows for many, many kinds of questions to arise, which I do not think would have arisen in a lot of the traditional writings, radical left-wing writings too, which didn't question the archive in quite the same way, didn't ask the question about knowledge power in quite the same way. The other thing that Ranjit Guha obviously emphasized, and I was talking to Chetan about this, so I will repeat what I said to him, was the question of location. And I think this is which Shahid talked about it at some length. This is of enormous importance. One of the loveliest stories I heard about Ranjita's concern with this question was from David Hardiman, who said he met Ranajit Guha for the first time in the National Archives and had a long chat with him about what he was doing. David was a student in his university in Sussex at that time, but not working with him, but of course knew about him, so went up and talked to him. And I don't know that you got a weekend at that point, but whatever you got. Ranajit, after listening to David Hardiman and finding out what he was working on, which was Khera district, the peasant struggle, nationalism in Khera, said after a couple of hours or whatever length of time it was, then what are you doing here? And I think that's the kind of question which is of great importance. All of us, when I was teaching in Delhi University, and anyone who still works here, recognizes that moving out of Delhi, even 20 miles, even across the river sometimes, brings you into another world. And it is very important for us to work with these worlds, that location. But I want to emphasize, just lift this or put it in a somewhat different way. Ranjitha recognized, as we all do, the importance of the space called the university, the importance of research on esoteric questions, questions that the market is not interested in immediately, questions and information that does not have immediate results, doesn't have immediate application. He was very concerned with this. He would say, in a way that was perhaps a little bit unfortunate, I haven't written for the panwala, he would say, right? But the point about that was, it's clear that the group of people he was writing for, Elementary Aspects was written for, was this kind of intellectual community. It was the kind of work that could be produced by the privilege of being in a university, having the time and resources for that kind of work on things that had no immediate commercial or intellectual sometimes or political fruit, you know, benefits from it. Something that, in fact, corporatism and the corporatization of the university and politics, you know, the political right all over the world is rapidly, seriously challenging, shrinking that space. It was a space that remained fundamentally important to Ranjit Guha, to all of us, and to all of us. But it was a university that was located, clearly, in a particular time and space. It was very important that state knowledge every day was being talked about from South Asia, from India, from the experience that all of us have gone through. Not because this was the greatest experience, this was the most ancient country, the most glorious, and not because Sare jahan se acha, Hindustan hamara, not for that reason. But because that location gave you a different history. They gave you a different sense of the state, of the everyday, of the archive, what have you. And in that sense, it was very important for Ranajit to keep saying to us, you know, whatever you do, wherever you work, keep the audience in Delhi in mind. Keep the audience in Calcutta in mind. He would say this repeatedly. He even told us when I returned from research and teaching in England to a position in Calcutta in the end, within a year, he said, I'm very glad you're living in a lower middle class locality. For him, there was something. I mean, you know, you could take that. I could take it as you know, you don't quite know what to make of that as a statement. But for him, it mattered greatly where this location was, what one's audience was, what one's interlocutors were. And so it's in that sense, and for that reason, that I think the question of the peasant then and now is as important and as it is, and needs to be focused. I think it is a good question to ask: what would a subaltern studies project look like today, when India isn't the kind of peasant country that it was? The agricultural sector has shrunk, the industrial service sector has expanded hugely, and so on and so forth. And I think this is what Partho would have talked about. And Partho's done that in various ways, talking about the new kind of peasantry and the new kind of peasant peasant politics in China and India. I'm not Partho Chatterjee, so I'm not I'm not going to try and do that. But I am going to try and suggest a couple of things which have changed or which call for different articulations of our questions. Prathama Banerjee asked earlier today a very important question of what is it, what was it in the politics of the 70s and early 80s that called for the centering of the figure of the peasant as the object of inquiry? What allowed the figure of the peasant to emerge as this particularly important central figure in a writing of Indian history and by extension the history of the modern in many parts of the world? And it's a very important question because I think one can one would have many things to say about political context, about the kinds of inheritance, about the kinds of political struggles that the Indian left, the left in the world, the post-war, post-Second World War world was struggling to come to terms with. What kind of new world could be made and how? The peasant was a vital figure in this for huge numbers of people across the world. And the question would be, how do you figure the peasant, or what was called the peasant then, how do you figure that peasant today? So if you take peasant insurgency, elementary aspects of peasant insurgency, both words, both terms, actually require a thinking, rethinking, which would be interesting, which would bear much reflection, and I think would be very productive if one reflected on them. What is the figure of insurgency today? Naxalism or Maoism, as it's called very quickly, you know, all kinds of encounters which are labeled that, all kinds of oppositional groups that are labeled that. But alongside that, farmer suicides, highest or amongst the highest in Modi's Gujarat, is not a part of development discourse that is heard commonly. But there is a phenomenal increase in this kind of resistance, politics, what have you. Dalit, OBC, minority politics of various kinds, you know, how would one put this together in a subaltern studies kind of project for our times? And so, I had 2 minutes, sir. So shifting from the title of, Ranajit's elementary aspects of peasant insurgency and on the notion of peasant insurgency, which is sharply focused question for those times, sharply focused because of the kinds of questions about social change, about radical transformation, about the new world that we were to make, focused for those reasons. I want to just shift to the wider problematic that I suggested to you informs Ranajit Guha's work and much of the work that allies, students, others working with subaltern studies have done. That is the question of state, everyday knowledge, today. Right? And I think if one thinks of that, here's one great example of what one thinks of as the state and its interventions, its coherence, what one thinks of the everyday, and what one thinks about knowledge with the media exploding and working in the way it has done. What does one think about the figure of rape and sexual violence against women in this country today, which has a huge focus now, attention to it? It seems to me that the question of state everyday and knowledge about sexual violence would produce a very different kind of distribution of resistance, of the possibilities of resistance, of the possibilities of solidarity and mobilization. than some of the questions that were raised 30 years ago. And I would want to ask alongside that, and I'm going to finish with the question, and that's it. I would want to ask about the place today then of the question of the will of the insurgent. The will, the consciousness of the insurgent. Who's the insurgent in this politics around the question of sexual violence? What is the will that we shall bring to bear on this question? And I suggest that the fact that we are able to ask these questions and read elementary aspects with benefit even today speaks of the enormous lasting value of the kinds of questions that he raised 30 years ago. Thank you.
I'm not Partha Chatterjee, but that's evident. I met a man called Stanley Fish in 1976, the year long before I met Ranajit Guha. The year that the translation of the La Grammatologie came out. And Fish said to me, that book is more purchased than read. And I said to him, I wouldn't have it otherwise. I think I'm going to ask Ranjit Da when I see him next as to whether he finally belongs to Stanley Fisher's crowd, a man who, because he never told me that he'd read it. So now that you've brought in this kind of prehistory, this is a question that I will ask him. You know, I am an interloper into subaltern studies. It was my great good fortune that Ranajit Guha called me in, but I think I disappointed him. Although, you know, he remains one of the most brilliant people that I have seen or talked to, I don't, after all, unlike the young men, well, young, we are all old now, the men, I'm older than they are, the men who spoke, I don't really have a feeling of loyalty towards him. I have a great feeling of admiration towards him. And it is out of that admiration I will speak. I'll tell you a story about how much I'm an interloper. My friend, Moira Ferguson wrote a piece on Mary Prince for Past and Present. And we were both in London at that time, and she said, Past and Present said to me that I should consult some of the subalternists for this to revise, but not Gayatri Spivak, the real subalternists. So this is Past and Present, you know, not even you folks. And so I said to Moira, look, I'm here, I'll give it a read. And so I gave it a read, and I suggested certain things, and Past and Present accepted it. But Moira never told them that she had actually spoken. This has been my relationship to the collective at a certain point, and also I'm a Europeanist. So, you know, I don't know that much about the history of South Asia. I'm Indian, and certainly, you know, I come from a family, plain living, high thinking, deeply interested in our own history and so on. But that's it. I remain suspended as, you know, I had been suspended in subaltern studies to begin with and to end with. I will say that looking at, and I was always a little afraid of him also. The only time that I think I did make him happy was last May, 2012, when I said, and this actually connects to what I'm going to say, when I said to him that my favorite book was A Rule of Property for Bengal. And he thought, you know, I mean, I was as usual, just kind of, you know. And so he said, yeah, you know that book? And I said, yes, and I gave him an account of the book. And his face just beamed, and he broke into this fantastic smile, and I thought to myself, at last the old man, you know, is happy with me, which is very nice. He is a brilliant historian, but uncomfortable with me. But at any rate, so I actually met him, I think in 1984 it was, wasn't it? I was 42 years old. The
Abortions, please.
No, Shamarshan told me that someone was looking for me, and I said, who? And he said, Ranajit Guha, and shaking in every limb, the next day I went and kind of met him. So that was also, I mean, I had already read Derrida, and I'd read Foucault, and I'd read all of these people, so to an extent, it wasn't that sort of a meeting, if you know what I mean. But what I would like then to, I was afraid of him, I still am somewhat, and I've been thinking how I would be able to say what I'm going to say if he were, in fact, sitting here. I think the reason why I said strategic use of essentialism, which has had an incredible shelf life, and I regret it. And it was said in, I said it in bad faith because I couldn't bring myself. I was so afraid of this group of historians, who, and I had reason to be afraid because, you know, literary criticism. I was doing ideology critique, but these people from their disciplinary enclave, not Ranjitha himself, they really thought that I was completely diluting what they were up to, and so on. So I had reason to be afraid. But what I'm going to do today, I would, I think, do anyway, because the reason why I said strategic use of essentialism was because I couldn't say what after all these years, and I took it back and all of that stuff, but somehow people liked it because it gave, not Ranjitha didn't need it. I was the one, he didn't need it at all. I don't even think he paid any attention to that phrase. But I said it because I was afraid to say what I do think, that the insurgency, the word insurgency has been used in the title and the text as the name of that consciousness which informs the activity of the rural masses known as Jacquerie, revolt, uprising, etc., or to use their Indian designations, Dhing, Bidroha, Ulgulan, Hul, Fituri, and so on. I thought even then that since I was not within structuralism, but within what came after as its critique, that the proper name was, and the giving of a proper name was in many ways a dangerous thing. So that but I couldn't say it, I dared not say it, and so I said, well, this was a strategic use of essentialism, and I believe I was not only in bad faith, but I was wrong. So this gives me, I'm very grateful to Shell and Shahid for asking me to speak here. This gives me an opportunity to say that this is how it happened. Now, in the epigraph to Elementary Aspects, which I bought, the book I bought before I met him in 1983. The epigraph is from the Madhyama Nikaya, and Buddha says to Asalayana, I have to see how he has actually modified the translation because he says he has. What do you think about this? Have you heard that in Yona and Kamboja and other neighboring Janapadas, there are only two Varnas, the master and the slave, and that having been a master, one becomes a slave. Having been a slave, one becomes a master. Now, we all know who's behind this quote, you know. I mean, it's like they came before Columbus. This is a kind of thing that has been going on for some time. And what I wanted to do was, I wanted to say that this is also, to an extent, Gramsci describing, not through the Buddha, but transforming the master-slave into master-disciple. So what, in fact, Gramsci did was, as this crowd will know, the Hegel's text on master-slave, which I dare say Ranjitha knows much better than this. He, and some people made this comment also during the day, in Gramsci's text, the Hegel's text is the Lordship and Bondage. That's a text about self-consciousness, right? That's a small section about self-consciousness. And what he says in it is that if you think of this as a master-slave kind of historical story, then in fact you will go out of the phenomenological story. You will make it stop. because this is not about actual masters and actual slaves. Fanon paid no attention to it, and I think historians, in fact, Hegel was making a distinction between history and philosophy. Ranajit Guha was not obliged to go with that distinction. So that's cool. I'm not saying he didn't know how to read Hegel. But on the other hand, what Gramsci does is he goes forward to the next session and he says, the environment reacts back on the philosopher if he's trying to change the environment. You know, this is sort of producing the subaltern intellectual, and I'll come to the end of Elementary Prospects in a minute. The environment reacts back on the philosopher and imposes on him a continual process of autocritique. It is his teacher. So what Gramsci does is he puts the new intellectual in the place, not of the slave, but of the next section, where in fact he's actually doing a riff on Hegel, because Hegel doesn't write about that one. So in this very passage where Gramsci is bringing up the idea of the production of the subaltern intellectual by the self-instrumentalization of the new intellectual, as Gramsci calls it. It's a long, wonderful passage, which I'm not obviously going to read. He says, when the thinker is content with his own thought, when he is subjectively, that is abstractly free, that is when he becomes a joke. This is this idea of the intellectual as not indeed, so that this kind of celebration of singularity, although as I say, it's my good fortune that I encountered him, to an extent, this is not really, for me, I don't see myself as Derrida's Derridi. I've been, in fact, knocked out of all that economic politics and the golden entourage of Derrida. I'm not one of them.
76 for us.
Well, that's you. but at any rate, so having said this, I would say that when you therefore come to the end of the book, as he says, and I'm reading this again, all mass struggles will tend inevitably to model themselves on the unfinished projects of Titu, Kanu, Birsha, and Meghar Singh. Now, I take the Hool Express almost every month in the morning at 6:45 from Howrah Station to Shiuri. And Jharkhand is under President's rule. It still is, isn't it? And Birsa Munda's statue stands in the Ranchi airport. So to an extent, and this book is Elementary Aspects, as you say, of Peasant Insurgency in Colonial India. I don't think we can actually assume a continuity between a colonial state and a citizen state. So that to an extent, however contaminated the idea of citizenship may be, and however we want to distinguish between places like post-colonial places like continental Africa, North Africa, India, and other areas of that sort from the whatever we might think of as clean and democratic areas. So when he says this, and then he goes on to quote Marx at 25, I quote, "The reform of consciousness consists only in making the world aware of its own consciousness, in explaining to it the meaning of its own actions." Then I think I want to, now there is a kind of sport, and I won't mention names here, some of you will know, of saying the Subaltern Studies is not Gramsci. I'm absolutely not interested in that. Absolutely not. But the colonial state is different from the southern Italy. But at any rate, what I would like to say, however, is that this idea, it is in order, writes Rondida, to assist this tendency. In other words, all mass struggles will tend to model themselves and so on. And you know that this is also a very deeply Hegelian concept. The tendency that becomes is brought to crisis. I remember at NYU some old Marxists, okay, Bertel Ollman and so on, you know, with their ponytails with gray hair and their guts hanging over over whatchamacallit, blue jeans, they had invited me as, it's true, they had invited me as a pomo, you know, postmodern person who didn't know anything about Marx, etc., etc., and also one of their old friends was a managing director of something or the other to show how good Marx was. And so one of the managing directors says, hey, but you know this tendency of the rate of profit to fall, it doesn't fall really. I mean, you know, there are windfall profits. I knew what the answer was, right? But I was damned if I was going to give the answer. And so I saw all of them. It's again a Gramscian argument that the man of the masses learns the conclusion, but he forgets the argument, right? So these characters, they say, no, no, there is a reason. But of course, the reason was that already in Marx, he's taking the Hegelian thing and he says that it's a tendency. If you don't bring it to a crisis, if you don't use it, then it's not going to work. It's going to be managed. So to an extent, when someone like Ranajit Guha uses a word like tendency, I mean, he's a deeply learned Hegelian who takes Hegel somewhere else, then he goes on to say, it is in order to assist this tendency to recognize itself. That's also very Hegelian, you know. It is in order to assist this tendency to recognize itself that we have defined the structure and related the moments of the paradigm on which it relies for so much of its drive and orientation. The purpose of this essay has been to try and explain the logic of a consciousness which informed some historic actions. This, one hopes, may be of relevance for all efforts meant to bring about a more abiding and comprehensive reversal, so that his idea of the readership is not just other historians. It's a very bold remark right at the end there. And it seems to me there you really have to quote someone a little more sussed out in terms of epistemology than Marx, writing to Ruge in 1 year before he started the economic and philosophical manuscripts. Huh? What happened?
No.
Oh, sorry, he's on the phone. I mean, think of this. That's very good. It's his driver. So, okay. All is well. I thought he was making some kind of a, interruption into my thing. That's all right. Anyway, so therefore, I will say that when he was writing about the rule of property for Bengal, on the other hand, he was writing, as he himself says, not just intellectual history, but what came to be called later a history of consciousness in an epistemological sense. He was really looking, and that's a very different bag of beans, different kind of consciousness. He was looking at consciousness as it is in the, if you like, in the colloquial sense, but so what? We speak colloquially. He was looking at consciousness as the graduation into agency. Into agency. And there, Partho says something which is very, very useful, which is that he was, in fact, in 1963 already, articulating a paradox. A paradox that, you know, there's that apocryphal quote that Homi made up, and we never could find it, but it's a very good quote, which is that perhaps one of you actually know the source, and then you'll tell me, and I'll stop saying apocryphal, which was, that apparently John Stuart Mill said, I'm a liberal at home and a despot abroad. Anyone know? No, okay. Well, if you know, just send me an email and I'll apologize to Homi. But at any rate, this paradox, this is the paradox that basically Partho is looking at. How could it have been that the people who had this kind of wonderful physiocratic idea of reforming previous ways of thinking, when it came to settling, doing the permanent settlement, that they would in fact go against their own political, philosophical, and intellectual convictions. Now, I would like to suggest that this paradox is also effective in quite another way in the post-colonial nation. It's a performative contradiction, that it is in terms of this that the post-colonial nation, the citizens' nation, begins to operate. And I have myself a problem with describing subaltern practice in the post-colonial nation as we need to create violence or it is political society and so on and so forth. But the whatever that might be, and I'm not going to go into it, I think I'll speak for another 2 or 3 minutes because you want to talk. But it seems to me that in the post-colonial nation, this kind of performative contradiction has to do with, and I'm glad you mentioned land, has to do less with an insurgency that is still, and I think in, one of you mentioned this, and I'm completely in agreement with this, that is being given a proper name by much less brilliant people than Ranajit Guha, according to a kind of rational choice left vocabulary, and that I think is a genuine problem. Ranajit Guha is not a teacher of that tradition, but nonetheless, when you get this in this way, it seems to me that that really is a way of defining the citizen subaltern in the post-colonial nation that we should perhaps not always follow or accept. So I am much more interested, given my experience, as I said, I'm not a South Asianist. My only experience here is teaching as at Columbia, and it's 30 years, but and hands-on work, giving time and skill to training teachers, elementary schools among the landless illiterate, but nonetheless, I'm not an expert. So the therefore, what I would say is that if I were going to follow this into something, and I do believe that these are extraordinary texts, I would follow this into a consideration of what happened. Why did Article 31 disappear from the Indian Constitution? And I talked to Francine Frankel after you folks told me that it is she who had worked on land reform, and she was not really quite, she didn't quite know about the fact that Article 31 just went. You know, of course, there's 31A and 31B and so on, but if I were to give a presentation today, I would actually see the way, I'm not ready for it yet, I would actually see in what way this idea of land reform was managed. And you know, there is that part four where there's even talk of social justice. But then as you look at each revision, you begin to see how this is being done. And for me as a feminist, it's extremely important that just as much as in so-called metropolitan countries, it is birth that is brought in, it is heterosexual reproduction that is brought in order to manage the paperless immigrant and so on and so forth, citizenship, naturalized citizenship, barring citizenship, letting immigrant women come in who are pregnant or not above a certain income level and so on, so that they don't drop US citizens on US land. The idea of taking all of this is a management of reproductivity, which is a very, very interesting argument. But in the same way, within this complete undoing of land reform, once again, it is the family that's been brought in. This is very interesting for me also that when Ranajit Guha is talking about territoriality in this book, in Elementary Aspects, he agrees our use of the rooted in a local, this is page 279, our use of the concept of territoriality in this chapter and elsewhere in this work agrees with the conclusion of R.H. Lowy that the two types of union, by blood tie and local bond, are in reality intertwined. He doesn't take this all that far, but in terms of the absolute undoing of the so-called land ceiling, I would say that this, once again, we have to, Pulansas thinks that the family is just one part of fascist ideology. I'm not going to take your time now, but I hope the piece that I gave in Athens called Europa and the Bull Market, nice title, I hope that will be out soon, where I've been able to, since you know it was a long thing. So what that's where I will more or less stop, because I want to say one more thing. To say that for me, the idea of the peasant is not peasant insurgency in the, what I think these people, and they are my my co-workers and teachers and so on, the Dekaro Shamaj Kolan Shamiti, what they are, and he just gave this to me because they are trying. See, there are on the lower level of the civil service some people who are still idealistic, not all, but some block development officers, some 100 days labor officers, although the 100 days labor, I say that that's still manual labor. It's only the Borlocks who do intellectual labor. That's another argument. But nonetheless, when it happens this way, they are trying to use the state. Like you quoted Ranajit Das saying to you, Dipesh, state, gilteo parina, phelteo parina. You know, that's the pharmacontic vision also of a Gramsci. There he's really with Gramsci, that all of these things, hegemony and so on, for Gramsci, not Togliatti's Gramsci, but Gramsci, the writer of notebooks. I mean, Togliatti totally destroyed Gramsci by producing books. But the writer of notebooks, that Gramsci, he actually hits his head against the possibility of, you know, I mean, you critique governmentality, but not for the people who have had no access to the abstract structures of the state. So therefore, Gramsci's idea was to see all of these things as medicine and poison, gilteo parina, phelteo parina, and teach use so that in fact it can be more medicine and to know the dosage and less poison. And it's not going to stick because class has not disappeared in the rural areas. It's not going to stick unless there is a fierce epistemological project so that in fact there is no idea of protecting culture. Let history destroy culture and then let them begin mourning the loss of culture as we do. We and them, there is a difference still. I would, so here what Sunil Lohar, who has only 4 years of school, has done is he's taken everyone here and he's looked at the fact that on the pattas, the last column, he gave this to me not because of this, the last column, the patta land, that's of course complete. It's your driver calling you. The patta land is all what they call danga jomi, useless. But now they're beginning to feel that perhaps they can approach a BDO and use the structure to make, they're still not sure, but perhaps they can use the structure to create. So that's what it's called. There's a spelling mistake here. Bhumi Shamotal Karan, not Bhumi Shatal Karan is what he's written. So anyway, that's I think where I would go. I would go to the land situation and see how land reform was undone rather than follow the tradition of rational choice leftism giving names to peasant insurgency. Now, finally, I'll say that the question of rape is not, first of all, of course, it happens in the frontiers, but when it comes to the metropolis, a certain section of the urban radicals become somehow for the whole world a metonymic representation of all India outraged. That's another thing. But I would say that anybody who has experienced the class apartheid in education knows that this is not just a gender question. This is a question also of the fact that the enforcers of the law and the people in the street are educated according to that, not the lawmakers and certainly not the urban radicals, are educated in such a way that they internalize rape culture and bribe culture. There is no doubt in my mind, because as I say, 30 years of hands-on work. So we can't just think of, you know, I was asked by a newspaper to fight with my friend Jagdish Bhagwati about his opinion of men and women. I told him, look, I'm not interested in producing yet another Gachi Spivak fighting a man. Forget it. I'm not doing anything. Because the real problem is not located in his view of men and women or mine. It's a much more demanding, time-consuming, persistent epistemological effort, which is not going to be solved by any kind of law, because the law enforcers will still be in some other place. So anyway, I just wanted to end with that, because obviously I'm not talking about education, I am talking somewhat about epistemological change. I'm simply going to say for this occasion that it's an extraordinary book. Rule of Property is also an extraordinary book. Small Voice of History is also beautiful in bringing forth the interstices of these two extraordinary books. But if I were moving Elementary Aspects forward, I would today not look at Insurgency, but take Ranjit Da's work forward as, you know, in a humble way. I'm not a historian, and I've been seen as an interloper. But nonetheless, that's the way that I would take it forward in trying to learn the question of land, the constitutionality of land, the use of gender in the undoing of land reform post-colonial, the citizen state. I don't call it post-colonial. It doesn't necessarily always refer back to colonialism. So thank you for asking me, Shail and Shahid, and thank you all.